the process engineer at Fluid Air. She got a doctorate in mechanical engineering and a master's degree in chemical engineering too. As a lecturer at Hanoi University of Science and Technology in Vietnam from 2009 to 2012. And after 6 years as a researcher at the Technical University of Dresden in Germany, she joined Fluid Air in 2019. Now she is responsible for the production lab in North Rhine-Westphalia in Germany. And her expertise is spray drying, advanced oxidation processes, and also the isolation of active compounds from natural products. In her presentation, she will explain how electrostatic effects are helpful drying thermal and oxidative sensitive products. Dr. Lee, may I ask you to start?
Yes. I don't know if you can hear me now.
Yes, we can hear you.
Perfect. Yes. So thank you very much for your introduction. And hi, everybody. Good My name is Nalle, and I'm from Fluid Air Germany, or in Europe, actually. So, yes, as Mrs. Reutner already introduced, before I work in Technical University of Dresden, and I already joined PARTEC presentations for a couple of times. But now, today, it is really like my first time with PARTEC. So it was really a great pleasure for me, and taking this opportunity, I will introduce our technology, electrostatic spray drying. Yes, so this technology is very wonderful, and I hope that you will agree with me at the end of this presentation. And the technology can be applied for different fields, and thermal and oxidative sensitive products is one of our main target. And today I will introduce something about it. So through my presentation today, first I will talk a couple of sentences about us, about our company. And then I will introduce you the technology. After that, I will give you some examples as the demonstration of our applications. And at the end, I will conclude my presentation with the summary. So first, talking about our company, I am from Fluid Air, and you may be not very well aware of our name, but actually I think that you already heard something about spraying systems. Spraying System is our mother company. It is a private owned company, and it is founded more than 80 years ago. So our company is specialized in spray nozzles and spray systems, and we have the headquarters in Wheaton in the USA, and we have more than 90 sales office in the world. Spraying Systems also have some daughter companies, and Fluid Air is one of the daughter company. So talking about Fluid Air, we have the history of less than 40 years, and we joined Spraying Systems since 2009. Our headquarters now is in, we have a new headquarters, which is very nice, and it is located in Naperville in the USA. We are specialized for fluid bed, high shear granulation, size reduction, and also other process automation. And in 2016, we launched a new technology into the market in America, which is electrostatic spray drying, boiler dry, that I'm gonna present today. And 1 year after that, we start working in the European market. So talking about our technology, first, I would like to just to explain a little bit and to give you a picture of where we are now in the world of drying. So in this slide, you can see that I write down here two very popular technology which is used for drying. On the right hand side, you can see that it is the conventional spray drying, which is also the topic that we talk today, and also GEA already talked a lot about it, and I think that I have no doubt that you already understand this technology. So one of the biggest remark of this technology is about the drying temperature. Usually we have to use the high temperature of up to or even more than 200 degrees Celsius. And then also the product temperature is of course also very high. So this technology can be very challenging to be used for the heat sensitive products. For all of the heat sensitive products, nowadays we have a lot of different technologies, but freeze drying is one of the emerging technology. With freeze drying, we can dry with the very low temperature because we supplement water from the wet solid. And this one is, this technology is very nice, but is it also time and energy consuming? And also there's something that we need to consider. This technology, so far as my understanding, we have only the batch process. So in Fluid Air, what we are thinking is that we want to introduce something in between, like another technology, we can make spray drying cool. And with this technology, what we expect is that we will do something and to improve the conventional spray drying to allow it to dry at the mild temperature. So the product temperature expectedly would be in the mild range from 35, 40 degrees Celsius up to 80, 100 degrees Celsius. And of course, it is in spray drying, so we don't want to compete freeze drying in a way like we want to dry something with the negative temperature, so it is impossible for us. But hopefully after that, this presentation today, you will know that why I talk about our technology as a bridge between freeze drying and conventional spray drying. First, I would introduce the working principle of our technology. It looks a little bit like conventional spray drying, but actually if you look a little bit deeper, we will see that there is something, some features which are different. So our technology is also a co-current drying. It means that we have here on the top, we introduce both drying air or hot air together with the feedstock. In our technology, we use nitrogen as the drying gas. And the feedstock is also atomized via a bifluid nozzle under the electrostatic effect that I will explain to you a little bit later. And here, like all of these two fluids will enter the drying chamber from the top. What is special here is that the nitrogen gas, which is the drying gas, is introduced tangentially. So it means that the droplets, and then later when it is dried, we will have the particles. So the droplets or the particles will follow the cyclonic movements inside the drying chamber here. Under the drying chamber, we have the separation plenum. What is this for? You know, after drying, we have the exhausted gas mixing together with the dried particles, and we want to separate the exhausted gas. And we don't want to introduce the external cyclone because we want to have a compact system. So we integrate the separation plenum right under the drying chamber. Here inside, we have the filters, and working due to the difference of the pressure, the exhausted gas will go out here in this line, and the dried products will be folded down in the collection plenum or will go to the conveyors. The drying gas, or in this way, I'm sorry, it's not drying gas anymore, it is the exhausted gas. The exhausted gas depends on your purposes, can be recirculated or can be just to throw it away. So in the lab scale, you will not recycle the drying gas because you don't want to have the contamination. But in the bigger model, in the industrial scale, you will want to recycle the drying gas. So basically it is something like that, which is very nice, but it doesn't say something special from our technology. So what is special here in our technology is about our electrostatic nozzle that you can see in the middle of the diagram. Here we have the feed, we pump it to the nozzle. And then in the nozzle, we have the electrode. The feed will be charged. And then under the electrostatic charge, it will have something very nice. We will have the stratification of the component that you will see in the next slide. But then here after that, we will spray dry to the top of the machine. And now let's see like what is special with the electrostatic nozzle. First, let's say like under the electrostatic nozzle, what can happen? We work based on the difference of the polarity of the components. What does this mean? It means that when we apply the electrostatic field under this one, under the electrostatic interaction, the most polar component will go out on the surface of the droplets, and the least polar component will stay in the core of the droplets. So talking about the most polar component here in the system, what we have will be usually the water or the solvent that we need to dry. So thanks to it, the water or the solvent will go out and it will be easily dried. So in the conventional spray drying that you can see the drying curve on the left hand side, we usually have two periods. The first period is the constant rate period, where we need to dry the water from the surface of the droplets. And then after that, the shell will be formed. And after this stage, after this critical point, the water we need to transport from inside to outside of the droplets and will continue to dry. So here, the outlet temperature will be usually increased a lot. What about with electrostatic spray drying? As I already explained, under the electrostatic effect, the water will move out to the surface of the droplets so that we don't need to transport the water from inside out anymore. And thanks to it, we will use the heat from the drying gas as only the latent heat. And instead, we don't need to use the sensible heat to dry the water from inside because we don't have water from inside. Of course, it's in just only in the ideal case, but it is something like that. So because of it, the outlet temperature is also low. And in fact, with our model, the inlet temperature is usually between 60 to 140 degrees Celsius, and the outlet temperature is usually between 35-40 degrees Celsius to 60 degrees Celsius. And because the water stay like is moved to the surface of the droplets, so it will be easier to dry, and then we can maintain the very good moisture content from 2% to 5%. And the water activity is also very low, from 0.1 to 0.3, which meet the requirement of the food grade products. And also depends on some on the process parameters and also on the products. Sometimes we even have the water activity below 0.1, like something like 0.05 or something like that. So talking a little bit more about the electrostatic effects, we already talked or explained in the previous slide, but now let's take an example of microencapsulation application where we have three different components. So usually we will have a system of the active compounds and then of the solvent and also the carrier. So the solvent will be the most polar component, then it will go out to the surface of the droplets. The active usually will be nonpolar and it will stay in the middle or in the core of the droplets, and the carrier will be in the middle layer of the droplets. So after drying, what we achieve is that we will have the active very well encapsulated inside a layer of the carrier in the protective layer. And of course, we expect to have no solvent at all after drying. This one is actually very nice and totally different from conventional spray drying, as you can see from the left-hand side. Here in the conventional spray drying, the active and the carrier will be distributed randomly inside, both inside and outside of the particles, and the encapsulation efficiency is not good. With electrostatic spray drying, polar dry, the encapsulation efficiency can be very high and up to 90 or 98%, depends on products and also process parameters. So talking a little bit more about electrostatic effects, we also have a very nice feature of pulse width modulation. What is this? In this one, we just when we apply this mode, we charge the droplets with the high voltage and the low voltage. And we make it like a pulse. So it's something like for a desired duration, we have the high voltage and then we reduce it to have the low voltage. And then we have this pulse like high, low, something like that. So due to the charge difference, what we have is that the droplets will collide each other, and due to the charge difference, they will stick together and form the agglomeration. So in fact, what we have, what we usually have is that we will have the agglomerates, the powder after drying will show as the agglomerates, and it is the agglomeration of the different size particle, different primary size particle. And the particle size is, for us, is usually between a few to some hundreds micrometers. So talking about some examples of our work, we can mention like DHA oil and essential oil, because as I already said, we have a good microencapsulation. And we also can work with lactoferrin and whole milk, also microalgae, because some of these products can be very thermal or thermal sensitive, and they need to dry with the low temperature. We also have the application with natural resin. So you know that natural resins have a very low glass transition temperature, and usually in the commercial, like in the market right now, we don't have the spray dried powder, but for us, we are also able to spray dry the natural resins. Of course, we can also work with probiotics and also some yeast, some microorganisms, because we can work with the low temperature. And our powders have also good properties which can apply for pharmaceuticals. We have certainly some case studies on vitamin C and vitamin D. So let's first take a look at an example of drying lactoferrin. So you know, lactoferrin is one of very, let's say, like we can call it the gold component of milk, because we don't have very, let's say, like the concentration of lactoferrin in milk is very less. It can be a little bit more in colostrum, but still very low. And then this substance is needed to dry and will bring a very great value. So in this application, we made two comparisons. The first comparison is between freeze drying and electrostatic spray drying that you can see from the left hand side. When we compare the freeze drying and electrostatic spray drying, we have some first results. First, you can see here is the drying temperature. The drying temperature of freeze drying is minus 40 degrees Celsius. So we expect that we will have very, like we preserve very good lactoferrin at the end. But then with polar dry, we challenge ourselves. We don't want to work with minus 40. We want to work with the mild temperature, as we already saw in one of some slides before. And in this one, we apply the inlet temperature of 90 degrees Celsius, and the outlet temperature was 35 degrees Celsius. So as we already discussed before, due to under the electrostatic effect, water is driven out. So even that when we dry with the low temperature, we still can get a very good moisture content of around 1.5%. And this moisture content is slightly higher than freeze drying, but it is not a problem because 1.5% is already a very good moisture content. We also check the water activity, and the water activity is kind of comparable with freeze drying when both of the powders have the water activity of around 0.1. So now talking about morphology of the powders after drying. On the left hand side, you can see that it is the dried lactoferrin by freeze drying. And on the right hand side here, it is the powders from electrostatic spray drying. So you can see already here, the powders of freeze drying is kind of shiny and also like a little bit yellowish, brownish. Why the powders with polar dry looks like really like spray dried powder. So you can check from the SEM here. When on the left hand side with freeze drying, we see that we don't have the spray that we don't have the very good morphology of the powders because the powders are, I wouldn't call it powders. The particles here is something like it is mill or grout from after process with freeze drying, and we don't have the good structure of the powders. And on the right hand side is with electrostatic spray drying, where we can see that we really have the spray dried powders, where almost of the primary particles has a spherical shape, and we also have the agglomeration of the powders. So in the next.
Just one second. You have five more minutes because the time is already over. Just for your information.
Okay, thank you. I will make it faster. So after that, we also, let's say like we make a comparison between conventional spray drying and polar dry electrostatic spray drying. And here we check the active lactoferrin, and you can see that with the conventional spray drying, when we work with 150 inlet and 60 degrees Celsius outlet, we lost more active lactoferrin. And with polar dry, we really have a good challenge to still maintain almost 100% of lactoferrin, of active lactoferrin. So in this slide, I would talk a little bit more about the encapsulation. So with this one, we work with the essential oil, mint oil, which is very thermal sensitive, not very, but also thermal sensitive. And of course, with freeze drying, we don't have the good morphology of the particles. But then with conventional spray drying and electrostatic spray drying, we have kind of good powders. But then if you take a look a little bit more on the surface of the particles, you will see that with conventional spray drying, we have some small dots, which is the oils stained on the surface. And with with electrostatic spray drying, we have only some or very less oil on the surface. And the reason is that with electrostatic spray drying, as I already explained before, we have the very good encapsulation efficiency where the oil stay in the core of the droplets and the carrier stay in the middle layer. And at the end, we have the very good encapsulation efficiency, like you can see from this experiment. Last but not least, I want to show you some data of the viability of probiotics that we work on. So with this experiment, we work on the plantarum and we compare the freeze drying and the electrostatic spray drying. And you can see that and we also check the viability during 6 months in the store. So at time zero, or let's say like right after spray drying, the viability of the polar dried powder is comparable with freeze dried powder, that you can see that both viabilities are around 10 to power 10. And after 5 months, we still can maintain kind of good viabilities. And even like after 6 months, the viability just decrease only two orders of magnitude with polar dried powder. And remember that in literature, so we have the inactivation of the living microorganism after 3 to 6 months, even working with, depends on the formulation, but also when we work with freeze drying or with conventional spray drying, we lose a lot of viabilities. So with this slide, I would like to emphasize that polar dry are able to be used for the application for probiotics where we need to have the, let's say like good viability of the powders. We also have other good characteristics like particle size, hydration, flowability, and so on. But as I'm running out of time, so probably you can check or we also can discuss later. And then at the end, I would like to summarize my presentation. So with PolarDry, what we work is that we applied or we use the electrostatic effect to harness the ability of spray drying. Because of it, so we can work with the low operating temperature, we can have the high encapsulation efficiency, and our system is also an all-in-one system. We also have a full product line, as you can see in this slide. So we have the tabletop model or the feasibility model that can work in the lab. And then also we can have the bigger model which can work in the pilot or for R&D. And then we also have model 50, which is our largest model. And when you combine like four models together, so you will have the maximum evaporation capacity of 200 kilogram per hour. So at the end, I thank you for your attention. And also, I don't want to forget all of my colleagues who contribute to the work that I present today. And I hope that if you have any discussion or questions, I'm open for it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lee. And there are quite a few questions. Perfect. I would like to, perhaps Dr. Lee is also having something to add because she has seen all the questions about her presentation. I would like to give you the chance to, yes, have a few words.
Yeah. So because I can have a chance of only few words, so I can't say so much. But one someone asked me about the high yeast capacity that we have. So currently we are working on a design of the 1 ton per hour machine. So it is still on a design. So it is not already available, but hopefully in probably 2022, we would have it. Of course, you can also come back to us for further information about it. So some asked me about the inhalation and with the small size particle. Recently, we work on some lactose product project for inhalation. And the D50, the particle size D50 that we get is between 2 to 4 micrometers. So of course, we will have to see, like, it depends on the solid content that we apply to, but it's something like also promising. About the whey protein or the stickiness or adhesions, and also at the milk products, what we can say is that we have the very low fat content on the surface because of it. So we don't have so much the stickiness on the surface. And also due to the very, let's say like low water activity, we have the very good shelf life of the products. And we expect that after a few years, after a few months, we still can keep the very good flowability. You may check the YouTube links that probably later you will get my presentation through Powtech, right? Yeah, then you can check the link and then you will see some of our demonstration about the flowability. So talking about the crystallinity, what we did is that with milk products, we already checked the XPS, and then we didn't see the influence to the crystallization of the products. And we hope that, I don't know, it is just at least for milk or dairy products. But then also, usually crystallization is formed by cavitation or some other, let's say like some crystallization seed. And in our case, we didn't notice it so far. We also can, another question regarded to the porous particles. I don't know how porous it can be. But we also try to work before with some, like, for example, silicon dioxide, silica, for example. And yeah, the results is also very positive. Of course, it depends a lot on different applications.